Hello everyone, this is Hiroko Yamada, Nara Institute of Science and Technology. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizing committee to give me the opportunity to share our recent results in this symposium. Let me start. Recently, carbon nanomaterials are expected as next generation electronic materials for silicon. The preparation of pure nanocarbon materials with a single width and length is difficult by top-down procedure. Therefore, establishment of the bottom-up synthesis is required for the practical use. There are two types of graphene nanoribbons. One is armchair type, and the other is a zigzag type. We can say larger than is the narrowest zigzag type graphene nanoribbon. Zigzag type is unstable, but armchair type is more stable and has semiconducting properties. In 2010, Professor Muren and Professor Fassel's group reported the bottom-up synthesis of 7-AGNR from the DBBA. By heating of DBBA on gold surface, dehalogenation gave the biological intermediate and CC coupling for the linear polymer, and then cyclodehydrogenation to make the graphene nanoribbon. 7-AGNR has a bandgap energy of 2.5 electron volt. For practical use, less than 1.0 electron volt is desirable. To control the graphene nanoribbon bound gap energy, there are several methods. One is the control of ribbon widths, another is the insertion of heteroatoms, and the other is the edge modification. Today, I will focus on the control of ribbon widths. This is the theoretical prediction of bound gap energy. Depending on the width of the graphene nanoribbon, band gap is decreasing. And the AGNR is separated in three groups depending on the number of carbons in the direction of width. N is 3p plus 1, 3p plus 2, and 3p. These are reported monomer units for the AGNR, and these are the experimentally obtained graphene nanoribbon band gap energy. For 7-AGNR, 2.5 electron volt, 9-AGNR, 1.4 electron volt, and 13-AGNR, 1.4 electron volt. At first, we simply thought by making the heptasen dimer, maybe we can make the 15-AGNR. Heptasen molecules are the series of polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons composed of linearly fused benzene rings. Pentathen has a high carrier mobility and is a benchmark for organic semiconductors, but it is hardly soluble in common organic solvents and it is unstable under air. In 2005, we reported the hot precursor of pentathen, PDK. This can be converted to pentathen only by hot irradiation, and PDK is stable for heating. This is the hot reaction of PDK to pentathen in toluene. This yellow color is the n-pi absorption of PDK. By irradiation, the color changes gradually from yellow to pink, and this pink is the color of the fluorescence of pentathen. And then you can see the precipitate of pentathen, and the color of the solution changed to the colorless. It means PDK changed to pentathen quantitatively. Using this spot reaction, Professor Necker's and Professor Bettinger's group reported the synthesis of hexasen to decasen. Because these are less stable and the solubility is very low, they detected these higher ascents by UVBs and IR spectra in PMA matrix or in argon matrix at 10 Kelvin. Professor Cho's group reported the isolated hexasen by sublimation of monoprecursor for the first time. They can make the hexasen single crystal in situ and measure the single crystal FET of the hexasen for the first time. Independently, we also made the precursor of heptasen, 7DK2. This is a single crystal structure of 7DK2. We can isolate the anti-type of isomers. We also prepared the 9DK2, and this is almost the same synthetic scheme with Professor Bettinger's group, but the final oxidation condition is different. We use the Swan oxidation, and they use the tempo as the oxidant. So using the 7DK2 and 9DK2, Professor Fazel's group was successful to measure the heptasen and nonasen images. These are the STM and non-contact FM image of heptasen and nonasen. They are very beautiful images. If we carefully look at this reaction, this is the image, STM image of the 9DK2 on gold surface. Because we didn't get the single crystal of 9DK2, we didn't know which isomer we purified. But with this image, you can see the two bright spots. It means this 9DK2 is a thin type isomer. And by photoirradiation at 470 nanometer under ultra high vacuum on gold surface, we can get the very nice rod-like images of nonasen. And if we look at this image carefully, sometimes center of the rod is bright. These lateral protrusions were assigned to the cold ad atoms bound to the nonasen backbone. This is a simulation of this image. And this is consistent with the instability of the nonasens in normal condition. By SDS measurement, we can estimate the energy gap of HOMO and LUMO levels. This is the energy gap of pentasen, hexasen, heptasen, and nonasen. And the black line is the experimental data, and blue and pink are the theoretical data. Blue is the calculated one for the singlet open shell type structure, and the pink is for the closed shell structure. Comparing these lines, we can say that nonasen is a singlet open shell structure on gold surface. Since heptasen is unstable and also this is too large for the vacuum deposition, we changed this monomer unit to this 2BR7DK2. This is a photoprecursor, and in center we can put the 2-bromine atoms. Starting with this monomer, by heating to make the polymer of precursor, by photoirradiation to make the heptasen polymer, and by heating to make the 15AgNR. But it was not successful. What happened? This is a synthesis of 2BR7DK2 from the heptasen quinone. This is a NMR spectra of this 2BR7DK2. And this is a STM image after the deposition. Each line shows each molecule. And the interaction between the bromine and the hydrogen on the next molecule, this molecule arranged in this pattern. And the bright spot is the benzene ring, and the less bright spot is the diketone part. Anthracene part is very flat on the gold surface. By heating to 435 Kelvin, bromine is removed, and this kind of pattern was obtained. But the distance between the two molecules are a little bit larger than expected, 7.4 angstrom. It means there is a gold ad atom between the molecule. And this is a simulation of the image, and you can see the gold atom here. And because of the steric hindrance between the hydrogens on the neighboring molecules, the direct connection of the two molecules was impossible. And by heating to 535 Kelvin, the heptasen gold complex was obtained. In normal condition, this precursor is stable for heating. But on the gold surface, heating gave the hexagon from the circuit precursor. It was a TPD graph to detect the CO molecule by heating at 510 Kelvin. So finally, we were not successful to make the 15 graphene nanoribbon from this precursor. So we changed the strategy. In 2017, BPDDB was reported to make the 9-AGNR. So inspired this molecule, we prepared the BNDBB and BADBB with naphthalene and anthracene unit. This is the synthetic scheme of the monomers. Naphthalene and anthracene are orthogonal to the phenyl ring. This is important for the monomers not to connect to gold surface completely. And this is a on-surface synthesis of 13-AGNR from BNDBB by stepwise heating. This is the STM image and non-conduct FM image. The STS measurement suggests the 1.3 electron volt of energy bandgap energy, and this is inconsistent with the previously reported 13-AGNR from another precursor. With BADBB, also we got the 17-AGNR by stepwise heating. This is STM image and non-contact FM image. The width of the graphene nanoribbon is 2.5 nanometer, and the bandgap energy was 0.2 electron volt on gold surface. This is the smallest bandgap among the bottom-up synthesized DNRs reported so far. Since this graphene nanoribbon is not long enough for the practical use, we are now trying to make the longer graphene nanoribbon with the small bandgap energy. Okay. Finally, I'd like to thank to my colleagues and group members. I'd like to thank to Professor Roman Faisal and Dr. Jose Argyle and the group members for the on-surface synthesis of large arsenes. I also thank to Dr. Shintaro Sato, Dr. Junichi Yamaguchi, Dr. Manabu Otomo, and Dr. Hideyuki Jippo in Fujitsu Company for the on-surface GNR synthesis. And also, I'd like to thank to Dr. Yoshiaki Sugimoto in the University of Tokyo for the non-contact FM measurement. I appreciate all my group members, especially Dr. Hironobu Hayashi. He is a key person in this project. And also, I thank to my students. They never gave up to synthesize compounds. Finally, I'd like to thank to my financial support, and also thank you for your kind attention.